Hello all, and welcome to episode 8 of Force Majeure, Music in Times of Crisis. My name is Carrie Campbell with NEXT Ensemble, and in this episode, we will have part 2 of our look at the HIV/AIDS epidemic and musical responses to it during the 1990s. One of the first high-profile cases of AIDS was the American Rock Hudson, who died in October of 1985. On November 24th, 1991, the virus claimed the life of the British rock star Freddie Mercury, lead singer of the band Queen. He died from an AIDS-related illness, having only revealed his diagnosis on the previous day. In 1991, at a time when many AIDS sufferers faced rejection and discrimination due to ignorance about the disease, the American basketball star Magic Johnson announced that he had tested positive for HIV, saying, "It can happen to anybody, even me." Therese Frere's photograph of gay activist David Kirby as he lay dying from AIDS while surrounded by family was taken in April 1990. Life magazine said the photo became the one image most powerfully identified with the HIV/AIDS epidemic. Popular music in the late 80s and early 90s helped spread awareness about the disease and compassion toward its victims, working against widespread misunderstanding and stigma. Leveraging their celebrity status, benefit songs by artists raised money for AIDS research and treatment. Whether or not a song about the disease raised money for charity, popular music helped humanize the AIDS crisis for people with no direct link to the illness. The legendary Elton John wrote the last song for his young friend Ryan White, a hemophiliac who contracted HIV through a transfusion and was subsequently expelled from his middle school. Diagnosed in 1984, Ryan White became a de facto poster child for the disease, illustrating that people of every ilk were vulnerable. Elton John and many other celebrities took up his cause. After White passed away in 1990, John included the last song on his 1992 album, The One.
Yesterday, you came to lift me up, as light as straw and brittle as a bird. Today, I weigh less than a shadow on the wall, just one more whisper of a voice unheard. Tomorrow, leave the windows open. As fear grows, please hold me in your arms. Won't you help me if you can, to shake this anger? I need your gentle hands to keep me calm, 'cause I never thought I'd lose.
The fourth single off of Cyndi Lauper's 1986 True Colors album was a song called Boy Blue. She wrote the song for a dear friend who had died of AIDS. In an interview, she explained, quote, "I tried to write about my friend. I wrote about him personally. I don't know that my lyrics were good enough. I don't know that anything was good enough. Maybe it was too personal. I don't know. But I wrote it for him."
Yeah.
By 1993, more than a decade after AIDS was initially diagnosed, Hollywood finally went mainstream about the epidemic with the release of the film Philadelphia. The film is about a successful attorney, played by Tom Hanks, who was stricken with AIDS. Springsteen's song from the film won the Academy Award for Best Original Song and 4 Grammy Awards. Ain't no angel gonna greet me, just you and I, my friend. My clothes don't fit me no more. I walk 1,000 miles just to slip this skin. Night is falling, lying awake. I feel myself fading away. So receive me, brother, with your faithless kiss. Or will we leave each other alone like this on the streets of Philadelphia? 90s girl group TLC's smash hit Waterfalls deals with both the illicit drug trade in the U.S. and the HIV/AIDS epidemic. In the video for the song, a woman is seen convincing her partner to have unsafe sex, and later in the video, the boyfriend is shown inspecting himself in the mirror as he gets sicker and sicker. The lyrics say, "His health is fading and he doesn't know why. 3 letters took him to his final resting place." The British duo Pet Shop Boys released their ode to the HIV/AIDS generation with the 1990 song Being Boring. Neil Tennant and Chris Lowe captured the sentiment of those who grew up and came out during the early years of the epidemic, and revealed in an interview that the song was a kind of elegy for a close friend who had died from an AIDS-related illness during the late 80s. Lou Reed was known for recording the grittier aspects of the New York City nightlife, and one of those events that he recorded was the annual Halloween parade. In the song, he laments the loss of so many characters from New York City's gay hub in Greenwich Village, and specifically the loss of his friend as he experiences the parade alone.
Spill into my mug. There's a Crawford Davis and a tacky Cary Grant. And some homeboys looking for trouble down here from the Bronx. But there ain't no Harry and no Virgin Mary. You won't hear those voices again. And Johnny Rio and Rotten Rita, you never see those faces again. This Halloween is something to be sure. Especially to be here without you.
Here's the song you've all been waiting for. Dionne Warwick and friends, the friends were Elton John, Gladys Knight, and Stevie Wonder, teamed up to release That's What Friends Are For as a charity single in 1985 for the American Foundation for AIDS Research. The Warwick and Friends release, originally written by Burt Bacharach and Carol Sager 3 years earlier for a Rod Stewart album, raised over $3 million for the foundation and landed at number one for 4 weeks on the Billboard Hot 100. The song also spawned a benefit concert that raised over $2.5 million for various AIDS organizations. I imagine you'll have this one stuck in your head for at least the rest of the day. U2's song One was released as a single for an AIDS research benefit. The song topped the rock charts and has since been used many times to promote human rights or social justice causes. The Red Organization was founded in 2006 by Bono and Bobby Shriver to engage businesses and people in the fight against AIDS. The organization continues to do so today. The songs covered today helped humanize the victims of the AIDS crisis, encouraging empathy and support. We at Next Ensemble thank you for watching, and we wish you health and happiness, and we'll see you here next time.